Hi everyone, welcome back. We're continuing here with our group 3 cation separation. Recall that you had saved the supernatant from the original sample, which contains aluminum and chromium ions. Here you want to continue to steps 9 to 14, which is for the separation and identification of aluminum and chromium ions. The separation is done in steps 9 through 11. This part of the lab is almost always the one where mistakes are made. So I want you to pay special attention to the discussion and write them down in your notes or highlight them in the lab procedure itself. We will separate the two ions by precipitating aluminum and keeping chromium soluble as the chromate ion. Now, how do we precipitate aluminum? Well, it turns out that aluminum reacts with hydroxide in two different ways. At high concentration of hydroxide, aluminum forms a complex ion. This is the aluminate ion that we discussed in video 1. However, at low concentration of hydroxide, aluminum instead undergoes a precipitation reaction to form the solid aluminum hydroxide, shown here. So this is the reaction that we're going to carry out to precipitate the aluminum ion. The trick is to reduce the hydroxide concentration in solution. In the beginning steps, we had added sodium hydroxide in solution, resulting in high concentration of hydroxide. So to reduce the concentration, we must add an acid, in this case, acidic acid. The overall reaction is shown here, where the aluminate ion is converted to free aluminum. Now that aluminum 3 plus are in solution, we can add a small concentration of hydroxide to precipitate it. To do this, we use NH3 or ammonia, which is a weak base, and therefore only produces a small concentration of hydroxide. The overall coupled reaction between aluminum 3 plus and NH3 is shown here, producing the precipitate aluminum hydroxide and ammonium ion. The steps that we do here only affect the state of the aluminum ion. The chromate ion remains soluble throughout all these steps, so once we have the aluminum precipitated, we can centrifuge to separate the aluminum precipitate from the soluble chromate ion. The mistake most often occurs in missing the precipitate of aluminum, which requires enough aluminum and hydroxide present to form. However, sometimes students add so much volume that the concentration of aluminum and hydroxide is too low to form a precipitate. In steps 9 and 10, we are adding acetic acid to the free aluminum and then ammonia to precipitate it. This is when the excess volume mistake occurs. So I want you to be super careful here. To avoid this problem, we're going to change the procedure for the steps. In step 9, you will add one drop of acetic acid, mix it with a stirring rod, and then observe. If you see a gelatinous precipitate form, and the precipitate stays in your test tube for 20 seconds and doesn't disappear when you stir, then you have the aluminum precipitate. The precipitate will look like the picture shown here, or it may be dispersed, looking like the lower picture right here. Recall that your solution would actually be yellowish due to the presence of the chromate ion, so it won't look clear like the pictures I'm showing here, but the precipitate would look like this or this. If you don't see a precipitate when you're adding your acetic acid, then what you want to do is touch your stirring rod to a blue litmus paper to see if the solution is acidic. If it's not, what you want to do is repeat adding another drop of acetic acid, mix it, and then checking again for the precipitate. Again, if you don't see any precipitate, you're going to touch your stirring rod to a blue litmus paper to check for the acidity of the solution. You're going to keep repeating that until one of two things happen. Either you see a gelatinous precipitate or the solution becomes acidic by litmus. If you see a gelatinous precipitate, then you stop adding your acetic acid. And then you're going to skip step 10 and continue to step 11, which is a centrifugation step where you separate the precipitate from the supernatant. Now what happens if you don't see a gelatinous precipitate and then the solution is now acidic by litmus? You also stop adding your acetic acid. But instead of going to step 11, you're going to continue continue to step 10. And you're going to add one drop of ammonia mix and then observe if a precipitate forms. If you don't see a precipitate, you're going to repeat the dropwise addition of ammonia until you see a gelatinous precipitate. Again, you should see a precipitate similar to the one shown in this picture right here, either a top one or a bottom one. Make sure that that precipitate stays in your test tube upon stirring for at least 20 seconds. Once the precipitate appears, go to step 11 and centrifuge to separate the supernatant from the pellet. Okay, let me just summarize what I just said here, which is steps 9 to 11. Step 9 is the addition of the acetic acid. Again, if you see a precipitate during this step, you're going to skip step 10 and go directly to step 11, which is centrifugation to separate the pellet from the supernatant. However, going back to step 9, if while you're adding the acetic acid, you don't see a precipitate, and then you test the solution and it is acidic by litmus, you're going to continue to step 10 first, add ammonia until the precipitate is observed, and then once you see that, you move on to step 11. Now, regardless of which step you did, after centrifugation, you should now have a pellet that contains aluminum hydroxide and the supernatant that contains the chromate ion. Now, you're going to continue with the pellet first. You want to skip step 12, which is the washing step for the pellet. What you want to do is go directly to step 13, and what you're going to do here is you're going to redissolve the pellet by adding acetic acid. That allows the aluminum to be freed as the aluminum 3 plus ion. We then add the reagent catechol violet, which forms a deep blue or navy colored complex with the aluminum ion. That would be your evidence that aluminum is present. Lastly, we will confirm that chromate is present by adding barium chloride to the supernatant that you had from step 11 earlier. The barium ion will react with chromate to form a yellow precipitate, which is barium chromate in this reaction shown here. All right, let's now go to the end and briefly talk about safety and waste disposal issues. Just like last week, you will be using some concentrated acids and bases and some metal ions. So make sure you don't spill it on yourself or others, as they will cause damage to your skin. Please have your PPE at all times, and you want to discard all the waste in the chemical waste container. All right, when we meet in lab, we'll discuss any questions you have about the details of the group 3 cation separation, and I'll see you in lab.